Yeah, to go to the USA, he had only completed the first canto, and he took those, it was printed in 3 volumes, he took them with, he took some boxes, cases of them with him to America.
刚刚回到美国的时候呢，他这个博加瓦坛所有的部分只有第一篇的，而且他手上只有三册印出来。
And he would personally go and introduce them to people. When he would give a lecture, when he would present public program, he would also show the books to people. He would invite people to to take some of the volumes.
所以呢，他去到很多地方去拜访人家，就把那三本印刷出来的呢，去跟人们介绍，去跟他们讲述。
So, we're going to introduce you to the Srimad Bhagavatam here this evening. We're going to look at the very beginning, the first chapter.
好，我们今天就从很开头的第一部的第一章来开始。
So I'm sure all of you are a bit familiar with Bhagavad Gita.
我相信大家对《博伽梵歌》已经是很熟悉了。But
may not be so familiar with Srimad Bhagavatam.
但是对于圣典《博伽瓦坛》可能没有那么熟悉。Srimad
Bhagavatam is the fruit of the Vedic literature.
圣典《博伽瓦坛》是伟大经典的果实。And
Srimad Bhagavatam continues where Bhagavad Gita leaves off.
那圣典《博伽瓦坛》是接续着《博伽梵歌》的这后面的部分连接起来。Right,
in the Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna concludes the Bhagavad Gita by telling Arjuna to surrender, give up all your religious principles, all your material religion, and just simply surrender to me.
在《博伽梵歌》的结尾的时候呢， Krishna 怎么结论呢？他告诉，就是说，你们只要把放弃所有的宗教，只要来向我臣服就可以了。So
Srimad Bhagavatam goes on from that point that now that somebody surrendered to Krishna, then what happens?
所以《博伽瓦坛》就从那个地方开始，就是如果一个人向 Krishna 臣服的话，会怎么样呢？
So Srila Vyasadeva, he was a compiler of the Bhagavad Gita. He wrote the Mahabharata, and Bhagavad Gita was there in the Mahabharata. And Srila Vyasadeva also wrote the Srimad Bhagavatam.
So, the book, Bhagavad Gita, part of the Mahabharata.
And then he wrote Srimad Bhagavatam.
那么，我们知道呢，《博伽梵歌》是从伟大的《摩诃波罗》的一个部分摘取出来，也是 Vyasadeva 所注写的。那么呢，这个后面这个《博伽瓦坛》也是圣 Vyasadeva 把它写出来，就是我们说编纂经典出来的。So
Bhagavad Gita is sometimes compared to the primary study. Srimad Bhagavatam is the more graduate study.
所以呢，《博伽梵歌》就像是说初级的研究，那么《博伽瓦坛》呢就是进阶的研究。So
Srila Vyasadeva wrote the Srimad Bhagavatam after he'd written many other books. He had compiled 18 Puranas actually.
那么，Vyasadeva在他编纂了很多的书籍之后，他也编纂出了18部的往事书，或称为宇宙古史。There
were he wrote 6 Puranas for each of the 3 modes of nature: goodness, passion, and ignorance.
就是说，对于物质三种属性呢，每一个属性呢，他都写了6部往事书。 就是激情的、愚昧的、善良这三个属性，每一种属性都有6部往事书。
So it's confusing for people to read the Vedic literature or to read the Puranas. It's confusing because different conclusions are made in different scriptures. They will say that in some scripture, they may say Shiva is the supreme. In another scripture, they may say all the gods are equal. In another scripture, they may say Vishnu is the supreme.
啊，这样子呢，还是让很多人觉得困惑，因为呢，在每一个不同的经，每一个部分的经典的结论呢，有一些地方说，Shiva 是至尊主，那有一些地方呢说 Vishnu 是至尊主，有一些地方又说谁是至尊主，所以对人们来说是非常困惑的。
So there's often confusion from the different teachings, different scriptures.
所以这样就是说，从嘛不同的这个经典里面的教导呢，经常让人们觉得有一种困惑。
And Srila Vyasadeva himself, who had written all the books, he also was not satisfied with this work.
那么啊 ，Vyasadeva 他自己虽然写了那么多部书了，可是他自己本人还是觉得有一种不满足、不满意。
And that's why his spiritual teacher, who was Narada Muni, came to him and told him the problem why he was not satisfied.
所以呢，他的老师 Narada Muni 就过来告诉他是什么原因、什么样的问题让他觉得不满足。
Problem was, you have not properly glorified the process of Bhakti Yoga.
那问题就是说，他没有很恰当的去赞扬这个奉爱瑜伽。
You've given too much importance to karma kandhi or fruit of material fruit of activity.
因为呢，那一些经典里面太过多的强调，就是说在啊功利果报活动的部分。
And this led to Vyasadeva writing the Srimad Bhagavatam.
所以这个就让这个引出了这个 Vyasadeva 来写述这个国家瓦坛。
So the Srimad Bhagavatam begins with what we would call an invocation.
所以国家瓦坛开始是以一种啊，就是说一种呼唤、祈祷、呼唤来开始。
And you can see the first three verses of the Srimad Bhagavatam. They begin with describing the subject, and then the glories, and then the goal of Srimad Bhagavatam.
所以我们摘要的来说啊，国家瓦坛的第一篇第一章的前面的三个诗节是讲到这个国家瓦坛里面的主题，还有这个啊巴格瓦坛啊，对吧？国家瓦坛的光荣，还有它的宗旨。
So this is a custom in writing scripture shastra that they begin with an invocation.
所以这个是呢，在书写经典的这个习惯，这样的习俗，首先是以一种祈祷呼唤为开始。
We have one booklet called Sri Ishopanishad.
我们也有一本书叫做至尊奥义书。
No, Ishopanishad is from the Yajurveda, and you'll see there in the Ishopanishad it begins with an invocation mantra, one mantra invocation.
所以这个至尊奥义师是从这个四部伟达的 Yajura 伟达经所摘述出来的，而且至尊奥义书的最开头也是有一个祈祷呼唤的诗节。
But here, Srimad Bhagavatam, three verses are given, glorifying, then introducing us to the Srimad Bhagavatam.
然而在这里呢，国家瓦坛的第一篇第一章就用了三个诗节来荣耀这个国家瓦坛。
So that's the first three verses of this first chapter, and then the chapter goes on to talk about the sages who had assembled, many thousands of sages who gathered there in a place called Naimisharanya.
所以呢，这样开始的这个介绍他的宗旨跟祈祷之后呢，接着第四节是开始就告诉了人们在这个有一个森林叫 Naimisharanya 的圣人们聚集在那儿。
Naimisharanya is a holy place today. You can go there and visit. It's not far away from Ayodhya.
那 Sharanya 在现代，我们还是可以去到那边呢参访。它离那个阿尤迪亚，或是翻译阿约提那个地方，离得不远。
Sometimes it's just known as Nimshar, but the actual name is Naimisharanya.
有些时候人们现在有些人把它称为这个地名叫 Nimshar。
Nimshar, yeah.
Nimshar. 那它原来的全名是 Naimisharanya。
It's a big forest.
是一个很大的森林。
And 5,000 years ago, the sages all gathered there because they understood Kali Yuga was beginning.
所以在五千年前的时候，那些圣人们聚集在那里，因为他们知道这卡利年代已经开始了。
They were worried. The sages were all worried. What's going to happen to the planet?
那些圣人们就担心的，那这个星球会发生什么事呢？会怎么样呢？
Lord Krishna had left the world.
因为主 Krishna 已经离开这个地球了。
So the sages were concerned about the welfare of people in the coming Kali Yuga.
所以这些圣人们就开始担心呢，就卡利年代已经到来了，那人们会怎么样呢
？So they went. They chose this Naimisharanya because it's actually considered to be at the hub of the universe.
所以圣人们就去到这个地区，那么沙拉尼亚森林那里，那时候被认为这个地方已经是半个宇宙了。
And it's been a place where sacrifice has been performed for many hundreds of thousands of years.
然后这个地点呢，也是数百、数千年、上千年的这种所谓进行祭祀的地方。
So we're going to hear about this 1,000. The sages came there with the intention to perform sacrifice for 1,000 years.
那些圣人们聚集到这个地方呢，是想要来进行一千年的这样的祭祀牺牲。
And while they're there performing the sacrifice, they also wanted to make inquiries.
而且当他们在那儿进行这祭祀牺牲的时候，他们同时想要来做一些研究询问。
And they selected a person called Sutta Goswami to answer their questions.
所以他们选了 Sutta Goswami 呢来回答他们的询问。
And there were six questions mentioned there in the first chapter.
然后在这个第一章里面，就有圣人们问出了六个问题。
So we'll come back to the first three verses later.
我们等一会儿会回头看到最开始那三个诗节。
We want to talk about to get the introduction to what's happening in Naimisharanya first.
所以我们要来介绍在Naimisharanya 那边发生的怎么样的情况。
So you can see in the picture, you can see Sutta Goswami sitting up there on the high seat.
我们看到 Sutta Goswami 坐在那边比较高位那边。
And the person with the white hair and the beard who is standing, addressing him.He's the head of all the sages, and he's been selected to put the questions.
然后站起来那位头发苍白的这一位圣人呢，是大家派出他来代表他们把问题提出来的人。
Right, the person with the long white hair and the white beard, his name is Shonaka Rishi.
这个白头发、白胡须这个。这位站起来这位圣人他的名字叫 Shonaka Rishi
The very great sage, very elderly, very senior
一个非常伟大的圣人而且非常的资深很进步又资深的
Try to understand this This is taking place just before the beginning of Kali Yuga
所以我们来试着来了解这个情况发生在卡利年代
So people have a longer life. They had a longer life. They were not influenced so much by the age of Kali.
在那个时候，人们的年寿命比较长，而且不会受到卡利的这个影响。
So the sages described here, text number 5.
所以这个圣人这么描述在第一篇第一章第五节这么说的。
The sages were do their morning duties.
这些圣人们在做他们早上的所谓早上的修行，就是早课这种。
Customary, take advantage of the morning hours.
这是一般修行的习俗，就是利用早晨时光、清晨时光。
It's an auspicious time in the day, early in the morning.
这是每天中最吉祥的时刻，就是清晨时光。
And so the sages did their chanting their different prayers and mantras, and then they offered sacrificial fire.
所以圣人们就在那儿呢，进行他们念诵这个各种 mantra 祈祷文啊，然后在献上祭祀的各种贡品跟火祭。
And then they gave the nice elevated seat to Sutta Goswami, and they began to question him.
那他们用一个比较尊贵的座椅让这个 Sutta Goswami 坐在那儿，然后他们再向他询问。
But there, in questioning him, the questions were put with great respect. They did not challenge him. They were not foolish inquiries or challenging questions. They were respectful questions.
那他们呢，向这个苏塔格斯瓦米询问的问题是非常尊敬的，这样来询问请教，而不是挑衅的那一种那种所谓询问。
You know, sometimes when you're giving public programs, you may get very challenging questions.
因为有些时候呢，去到外面公众的活动里面，有一些会这个问着非常所谓挑战性或挑衅的问题。
Challenging questions would be something like, "Can God make a stone so heavy that even He can't lift it?"
挑战性的问题是这样，就是说你问着说人可以就问着说神可以造出那种石头连他自己都拿不起举不起来的石头吗？
It's a little challenging kind of question.
问的这样的问题是说心怀挑衅挑战这种的问题。
Of course we can counter that kind of question also with a challenging answer.
当然我们可以来抵消这种提问，就是我们也可以用具有挑战性的回答再反给丢给那个人。
You can tell him that yes, you're that stone because you ask such a stupid question that even God can't pick you up.
我们可以跟他回答说你就是那颗石头，你是这么顽固连神都举不起你来了，就没办法移动。
So like that, questions should be of the right nature.
所以提问的问题必须要是正确的这种性质的问题。
Srila Prabhupada sometimes was sometimes disappointed by the quality of the question.
Srila Prabhupada 有时候对人们提问的问题的性质有时候感到失望。
And sometimes you get people coming from other traditions, other faiths, and they come to challenge. They don't come to really hear.
有时候也遇到一些人呢，他们来提问的时候是在来挑战的，不是真正要来聆听的。
So we want to understand about the special qualities of the person like Sutta Goswami who is selected here to sit on the seat and to answer the question.
所以我们要来了解一下这位 Sutta Goswami 被人推崇起来就是说他坐在一个尊贵的位置上来进行答问。
So mentioned here that Sutta Goswami,You are completely free from all vice.
这问题就是说这些圣人们就说可敬的苏塔格斯瓦米啊，你是完全没有任何所谓邪恶的品质。
So, Sutta Goswami sitting on the elevating seat, because of his elevated status in qualities.
所以苏塔格双明坐在比较高阶的位置，是因为他的个人的品格呢是非常高尚的，人们非常尊重他。
He is a representative of Śrīla Vyāsadeva.
他是代表的圣 Vyāsadeva.
And the seat which he's sitting on, that is called a Vyāsasana, the seat of Vyāsadeva.
所以 Vyāsadeva 所坐着这个座位称为 Vyāsasana.
So Sutta Goswami's three vice. What are vices? Vice means illicit activities like intoxication, gambling, and eating impure foodstuffs, and illicit association with the other sex.
所以这个邪恶的品质是指什么呢？就是说非法性行为啦，饮酒作乐，沉溺于感官享乐等等。
These four qualities are things which destroy the principles of religion.
那这些品质就摧毁了宗教的原则。
We'll see in the Srimad Bhagavatam that the symbol of religion is the bull, the male cow, where Haluji stands on four legs, and each of the legs of the bull represent one of the pillars of religion.
好，我们接着会描述的这个宗教原则，这个这种象征。代表是由一头公牛来代表，然后呢，四个宗教原则就是这一头公牛的四只脚代表的四项原则。
They're mentioned in the scriptures as satyam, truthfulness.
在经典里面描述这四个品质，其中一个第一个是 satyam， 就是诚实真理。
Truthfulness, to be truthful is a very important quality.
要诚实真实是非常重要的品质。
And then socham, cleanliness.
在 socham 呢，就是说洁净。
And then daya, mercy.
再来就是 daya， 就是仁慈或是说慈悲。
And tapa, austerity.
再来是 tapa, 苦行。
So it's pointed out that in the Kali Yuga,practically these four principles are destroyed almost to nil.
所以这四项品质在卡利年代里面呢，几乎都已经都被摧毁。
People are not very truthful or clean or austere. They're not very austere. They're not very merciful.
这个年代的人基本上已经不太诚。没怎么诚实了，也不干净，然后也没有慈悲，也不去做苦行牺牲。
Mercy is destroyed by eating impure foods, particularly animal foods, like the not only animal meat, fish, eggs. These are considered impure.
这个慈悲仁慈呢，这个品。怎么被破坏呢？基本上是我们吃了那些不纯洁的食物，就是失去那个纯净。
So we want to have the principle of cleanliness and mercy. We should show mercy to other living entities, and that means that we shouldn't encourage killing of them.
所以呢，我们也要对其他的生物展示出这个慈悲仁慈哈，不要去杀害，也要告诉人们不应该这么去杀害杀生。
We often see here in Taipei, we see a lot of big signs, beef noodle, you know, import the animal the cow flesh and they mix it with their noodle.
我们在台北或一些大城市常常看到那个。路边有那个大招牌，说卖牛肉面啊、牛肉什么的这种食物。
So that is not merciful.
所以这种情况就不仁慈了。
If you have to see the animal slaughtered, it's the most cruel business of all activities in the world.
如果说你去看动物在被屠杀的时候，是最非常 常残酷的啊，几乎是世界上所有的什么活动里面最残酷的。
Actually, it's a great fortune that here in this country of Taiwan, the people in the countryside they produce all kinds of variety of vegetables and fruits.
那实际上在台湾虽然非常幸运，因为在台湾里面呢，有很生产很多这个我们素食的食物食材。
But still, people are so unfortunate and sinful that they will.They'll kill the cows and import the meat from some faraway country.
而虽然这样，人们还是那么罪恶的去杀害这些牛啦、动物啦，就是这些可怜的生物这样子的被杀。
Sometimes people say, "Well, I didn't kill the animal. I'm only eating it."
有些时候，有一些人会说，我没有去杀那些动物，我只是吃着而已。
In Thailand, which is also a Buddhist country like Taiwan, in Thailand the monks all eat meat.
在泰国呢，跟台湾一样，虽然是一个佛教国家，可是在泰国的这些和尚们呢，都吃肉。
They beg every morning. They will beg in the marketplaces, and people come and give them meat and fish. And,
那他们就去，外面化缘乞讨，然后去到菜市场，人们也是给他所谓化缘，给他丢这个肉类的食物。
So I had an experience in Thailand one time. I was traveling in a town where we didn't have any center, and so I went to a Buddhist temple, and I asked at the Buddhist temple, you know, could you accommodate me for the night?I told them I'd been a monk for many, many years, and so they agreed to let me stay in the temple for the night.
我有一次经验，我在去泰国去到有一个城镇呢，没有我们伊斯兰的庙，也没有中心，所以我去到一个佛教的庙里面，跟他们就是说请求说我已经很多年在出家了。所以呢，我也是一个和尚。那我求你让我这样过一夜，那他们同意让他过一夜。
And the next morning, they were having their breakfast, and they said, "Would you like to have something?"
那第二天早晨呢，他们就是说要派发早餐呢，就说你要不要来吃一点
？So I told them, I said, "Well, I'm a vegetarian," and they said, "Oh, well, then we have nothing."
我跟他们说。哎呀，可是我是吃素的，我素食者。但是他说，那我们没有什么东西是素的。
Everything they had was some kind of meat, fish.
他们的食物总是会有肉或是鱼之类的。
And their thinking is that, well, we didn't kill anything.
那他们的想法是说，哦，我们没去杀这些生物啊。
But according to Vedic teachings.Even you didn't kill the animal. If you eat or if you cook, like that, you're involved with the sin.
那根据吠陀伟达的教导，就是说如果关于吃肉食，不管你是吃的人，或是说你杀害，或是运送或买卖，只要跟这个肉食相关的，你们都要。接受这里面得到的反应，或者说报应。
So it's important to educate people to get away, to get free from the vice.
对，所以这是非常重要来教导人们，就是说让他们脱离任何的恶行或罪恶。
So mercy is an important quality. Showing mercy to the animals is a very basic point.Spiritual friend.
所以这个慈悲啦、仁慈是很重要的品质，甚至对其他的动物也是一样，要对他们有这种慈悲。
Another quality is the austerity.
另外一个品质就是我一般说的这个苦行。
Austerity is destroyed by intoxication.
这个。苦行这项品质被一个人就是说沉溺感官作乐而破坏。
And one kind of intoxication is pride. So we want to give up pride. We do want to develop humility.
有一种感官的沉溺是从骄傲出来，我们甚至连骄傲都要去去除。
And people who are taking intoxication are generally not very humble.
做各种感官沉溺的这些人，一般来讲不是，他们不是谦虚的人。
Cleanliness is another important religious principle, a basic principle which is taught everywhere in the world.
洁净呢是世界上各种所有宗教都教导的非常基本的原则。
And cleanliness is not only external but also internal.
这个洁净呢不只是外在的，而且包括内在的。
So we can purify ourselves internally through the chanting of the Hare Krishna mantra.
所以我们可以经由念诵 Hare Krishna 这个 mantra 来净化我们的内在。
And externally, we must be very careful about how we associate with the other sex.
然后在外在呢的洁净，也包括我们要很小心去注意我们跟什么样的人在交流。
So Sutta Goswami is described, he is free from all vice.
所以 Sutta Goswami 就说要脱离各种的这种邪恶罪恶的坏习。
Means he's not taking any kind of intoxication.
这表示也不接受任何的这让人沉迷的这种感官的事项。
He is merciful, he doesn't eat any meat.Fish or eggs.
也非常仁慈，不吃任何的鱼肉蛋的食物。
He's not involved in any gambling activities.
而且呢，在诚实方面也不参与任何要推敲的赌博的这种性质的活动。
And he's not associating in any illicit manner with the others.
而且在洁净真实也是不。没有非法的这种交往，非法的性行为。
So these are preliminary qualifications for self-realization.
这是为了自我觉悟的最基本的这个资格，基本的要求。
The pillars of religion.
也是宗教的柱子一样。
Another qualification of Sutta Goswami is given.Here it's mentioned he is well versed in the scriptures which are famous for religious life.
而在除了这个四个原则之外 ，Sutta Goswami 这边又提出了一项，就是说一个人要对于经典的诗诀非常的熟悉。
He knows the Puranas and the histories of all which are described there in the Puranas.
所以呢，这个这些经典诗节包括就是说往事书宇宙古史还有这个甚至说经典上的历史方面的书籍
He's gone through them under proper guidance and he's also explained them
所以这是怎么样得到这样的知识呢就是经过恰当的引导而且是被很好的解释出来的
SoTo sit on the Vyasasana, to be the representative of Vyasadeva, one shouldn't be an illiterate person. One has to be educated in the teachings of the scripture.
所以坐在这个讲述的高位 Vyasasana 这个位置的人必须是对于经典非常熟悉的，而不是随便的文盲啊，不懂得经典的人可以坐上去的。
And the process of learning the scriptures is by hearing them from a qualified teacher.
然后呢，去研读经典是经由，就是说有一个有资格的老师的引导下去研究经典。
It's not enough just to sit at home and read the book on your own.
在家里自己坐着去看这些书呢是不够的。
Reading, of course, is good.But there's something better than just reading.
当然去读这些经典读书是很好的，可是还有比这个更好的情况。
What is better? The better thing is that you go through the scriptures under the guidance of a teacher.
是怎么样比较不好比较更好呢，就是说啊，在一个恰当有资格的老师的引导下去研读这经典。
Just like you want to be a doctor, you don't just sit at home and study medicine books on your own.
就好像如果你想要成为一个医生的话呢，你不可能只是在家里自己去读书就可以了。
You have to go and study in a medical college under the qualified teachers.
而你是必须要去医学院有受着有资格的老师的教导这样的指导。
And another qualification of the teacher like Sutta Goswami is that not only has he read the books, but he can explain them.
而另外一个资格就是说，像这个 Sutta Goswami， 他不只是了解的经典，甚至他自己有办法把经典讲解释出来。
Though there's something even more important than just reading the books, and that is discussing them together.
所以更重要的就是说，除了去读这个研读之外，而且要来就是说互相讨论。
You have to discuss them together, and someone should explain them.
必须要一起来讨论，而且必须要有一个人来解释。
Reading the book, that's the beginning.
去读这些书只是个开始。
But once you've read it, then you want to discuss it with each other.
当你读了这些书了，你会想要跟别人一起讨论。
What's the meaning? What's it all about?
啊，就是说你读了这些东西是什么？那里面是说什么？都在做什么呢？这意思是什么
？Just like in Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna describes the process of acquiring transcendental knowledge.
啊，就好像在《佛家梵歌》，Krishna 也说了，一个人要来询问这超然的知识。
Right? Do you know from the fourth chapter of Bhagavad Gita, there's a famous verse in the fourth chapter.
在佛家梵歌的第四章有这个一节很有名的诗节。
Padvidi pranipatena puriprasnena shivaya upadeshanti te jnanam jnaninas tadvadarshana. Lord Krishna is describing the process of acquiring transcendental knowledge.
所以菩萨在描述着这个获得超然的知识的程序。
Lord Krishna said, just try to learn the truth by approaching the spiritual teacher.
菩萨就描述的就是说去向一个灵性的老师来询问这些问题。
And inquire from him submissively and render service to him.
必须要谦卑地向他询问，然后来向他献上服务。
So that's how you approach the teacher.
那这是说你们怎么样来走进老师的程序
？And then the teacher's qualification is described.
然后这个老师的资格也在这诗里面描述着。
Upadeshanti te jnanam jnaninas tadvadarshana. The teacher should be tadvadarsha.He's seen the truth.
而这个老师必须是 Tattva-darshana， 就是说他已经见到真理的了。
But not only has he seen the truth, he can explain it to others also.
而不只是说他自己见到了真理，而且他可以向别人来解释说明。
Sometimes you get people who say, "Yes, yeah, I saw the truth. What was it? Can you tell me?" I can't put it in words.
有时候你会碰到人们说他说我见到了真理。那你问他说那是怎么样？他说我没办法用言语来描述。
So that kind of teacher is not going to help you very much.
如果是这样子的老师，就没办法给你多少帮助。
But here Sutta Goswami is described that he studied the scriptures under qualified people.
那这里呢 ，Sutta Goswami 在描述的就是说，人们 在做研读经典呢，要必须受的有资格的引导者来教导。
And he's also had the, he's been explaining them, he's been talking about them and teaching them to others.
而且这个老师是可以啊去跟他们教导，去跟他们解释这经典的内容。
It is said there are some people who act perfectly, but they don't preach.
啊，有这样说的，有一类人呢，他们是啊，自己的言行是完美的，但是他们没有传教，不会去说。
There are other people who preach, but they don't behave properly.
但是有另一类人呢，他们去说去传教，可是他们自己的行为不恰当。
So, both are important.
但是就是说，言行的恰当跟这去传扬这个是两者是都是重要的。
We say achar and prachar。
就说 achar 跟 prachar 这两个字来说。
Achar the behavior, the proper actions, and the prachar the speaking, the explanation。
这 achar 就是说行为行动必须是恰当的 ，prachar 就是讲述叙说。就是也是要讲得恰当正确。
So Sutta Goswami, he is qualified that he not only acts properly, but he also teaches properly.
所以 Sutta Goswami 不仅是他的行为是恰当正确，而且他的传教也是他的言语也是恰当正确的。
Actually, Sutta Goswami is the son of someone called Romaharshan Sutta.
那实际上 ，Sutta Goswami 是这个 Romaharshan Sutta 的儿子。
Romaharshan Sutta was one of the persons who Lord Balaram happened to kill.
Romaharshan Sutta 被巴拉让所杀的人。
He was Romaharshan was actually a disciple of Srila Vyasadeva.
Romaharshan 呢，实际上是圣 Vyasadeva 的门徒。
And Srila Vyasadeva had given him a section of the Vedas to be responsible for.
那Vyasadeva 给这个 Romaharshan 就是说这个一系列的伟大经典，让他去所谓负责照管。
And initially, Romaharshan was the one to speak to the sages.
最开始呢 ，Romaharshan 呢，他想要在这个上面来，所谓在圣人面前讲道。
And it happened, Lord Balaram came to Naimisharanya 5,000 years ago. All the sages were there, and Lord Balaram came into the assembly, and Romaharshan was sitting on the big seat, and all of the sages, they all honored Lord Balaram, either by folding their hands or bowing their heads.
那当这个巴拉让到了现场的时候 ，Romaharshan 坐在这个高位上。那当时在场的圣人都来向巴拉让致敬，有的用拱手的，有人用顶拜的。可是 Romaharshan 却这样子一副高高在上的坐在这个座椅上。
So Lord Balaram noticed that Romaharshan was not offering any kind of respect at all.
那巴拉让就看到 Romaharshan 没有表示出一点敬意。
So Lord Balaram took a blade of kusha grass and he pierced the heart of Romaharshan.
那主巴拉让呢就随便拔了一根这个 kusha 草，就像类似我们说令草一样，就是这样，只是一根草尖就穿到这 Romaharshan 的心脏过去。
Romaharshan died on the spot.
所以这个 Romaharshan 当场就这样把他掐死过去。
And the sages were all shocked, and they told Lord Balaram, "We had given him a benediction of a long life. We promised him that so he was going to teach us, and we'd all blessed him that he will have a long life."
啊，这些圣人们看到这个情景非常的惊讶，他们就对巴拉让说呢。我们就是曾经祝福 Romaharshan 让他可以长寿就是寿命长久这样子。
So the Lord Balaram said, "Well, I can bring him back to life if you want."
那主巴拉跟他说啊，如果你要让他死而复活的话，我也可以这样子做。
So they say, you say, no, no, we know you are the supreme Bhagwan. You are God Himself. You've chosen to kill him. We don't want to check, but we give the benediction. What about the benediction we give him?
那么这些圣人们就被巴拉拉说啊，不不不，我们知道你是至尊主，你怎么做我们都接受。但是呢，对于我们对这个圣人原来的祝福，这个恩惠要怎么办呢？
And then Lord Balaram said, well, we'll give that benediction to his son.
那主巴拉让就对他们说，那我们就把这项恩惠，这个祝福给他的儿子。
The son is not different from the father, so Sutta Goswami received the benediction which was meant for his father.
在一个意义上，就儿子跟父亲是没有分别的，所以把这项祝福就给他的儿子。
So you see, even one may be qualified, educated, and so on, but if you don't behave properly, then you're liable to punish, be punished.
所以我们可以见到，就说即便我们在已经算是有资格，可是我们的言行如果不恰当的话，我们可能也会被主把它踢下来。
Okay. And then Srimad Bhagavatam continues.We hear more about the qualification of Sutta Goswami.
我们会接着来更多的听到 Sutta Goswami 的资格。
So it's mentioned that he is the eldest and a learned Vedantist.
最开始就说了 Sutta Goswami 是最年长的，也是最有学问的这个伟达知识、伟达经典。
So that's why, although so many other great sages are there, that Sutta Goswami is sitting on the elevated seat.
也是这样子呢，就是说，在场那么多的这个圣人在场，他们都推崇 Sutta Goswami 坐上这个上位。
And it's mentioned that he's acquainted with the knowledge of Srila Vyasadeva, who's the incarnation of God.
而且就说着呢 ，Sutta Goswami。就是充满着这个伟达经典的知识，而是 Vyasadeva 所赋予的。他也是Vyasadeva 是主的文学经典化身。
Actually, Srimad Bhagavatam was spoken previous to this incident here in Naimisharanya, and it was spoken when Sukadeva Goswami spoke to Maharaj Parikshit.When Maharaj Parikshit had been cursed to die in 7 days.
实际上呢，在这个地点呢，之前也是由这个 Parikshit 国王呢被所以被诅咒的这个7天就会死的时候呢，Sukadeva Goswami 也在场讲述着国家瓦台。
So at that time, Sutta Goswami had been in the audience. He'd also heard Sukadeva Goswami speak.
当时早些的时候 ，Sukadeva Goswami 在讲述国家瓦坛的时候 ，Sutta Goswami 也坐在这个听众之席，聆听这个国家瓦坛。
And Sukadeva Goswami is the son of Srila Vyasa.
那 Sukadeva Goswami 是圣 Vyasadeva 的儿子。
And he has heard the Srimad Bhagavatam directly from his father Vyasadeva.
所以呢，他从自己的父亲 Vyasadeva 那边去聆听到这个圣典佛教瓦台。
So Sutta Goswami heard Sukadeva Goswami speak, and now Sutta Goswami is coming to speak. He came back to Naimisharanya and he's speaking it to the sages.
所以Sutta Goswami 曾经聆听了 Sukadeva Goswami 的讲述了，那这个时候他又回到这个森林来跟其他的圣人们继续讲述。
So not only did Sutta Goswami know about Vyasadeva, but he was also acquainted with other sages who were all in knowledge of physical and metaphysical knowledge.
所以呢，苏达狗耍米不止跟苏卡德狗耍米啊，就说很熟悉，而且呢，啊，苏达狗耍米也是对于经典，不管是说物质上的知识，或是形而上的知识呢，都非常的熟悉。
Actually, there are six different philosophical systems by which this kind of knowledge is transmitted.
实际上在知识呢有六种系统在就是说怎么样的传述知识有六种系统
From the great sage Gautama you have the philosophy of Nyaya or logic、
啊、首先呢有一个是 Gautama 这个圣人这一类的知识称为 Nyaya
logic、
啊、就是逻辑学推理逻辑的
and then you haveSankhya philosophy from the great sage Kapila.
再来有桑杰罗素论哲学是由 Kapila 所传的。
You have also yoga which comes from Patanjali.
还有再来另外一种是瑜伽从 Patanjali 所讲传述的。
And you have Jaimini, the sage Jaimini, he gave us the philosophy of Karma Mimamsa.
然后再来讲迷你他给的这种知识叫 Karma Mimamsa
Srila Vyasadeva gave us the Vedanta the teachings of Vedanta、
嗯、那 Srila Vyasadeva 给的知识是 Vedanta 就是伟达知识的这个结论
And there was a person called Kannada who gave the impersonal philosophy
还有另外一个叫 Kannada 这个人他讲述的是非人格的哲学
So Sutta Goswami as a representative of Vyasadeva is familiar with all of these different teachings、
嗯、那么 Sutta Goswami 呢他跟 Sukadeva Goswami 也是非常、就是两个非常熟悉的然后他对着这、Sutta Goswami 对这六种知识的、内容都非常的熟悉
So described here about what kind of person he was that he was submissive and he was faithful to his spiritual master
所以在这里是说到呢他是、这样的人是非常这个、谦卑臣服的人而且是对这个教导跟老师很有信心的人
So because of his good qualities, he received the blessings from his spiritual teacher.
由于他这样子的品格呢，得到他的老师的祝福。
By the mercy of the spiritual teacher, we get the mercy of Krishna.
所以由灵性导师的仁慈，我们得到Krishna 的仁慈。
Without the mercy of the spiritual teacher, then it's only habit.
若没有灵性导师的仁慈的话，有时候会是一种灾难。
Some water for you. So the sages in Naimisharanya they're asking Sutta Goswami that you please tell us what you have learned from these people.
所以在 Naimisharanya 的这些圣人们就问 Sutta Goswami 啊，请你来为我们讲述你所学从 Sutta Goswami 里面所学到的。
We don't want to hear just something which is.Manufactured, which is just some speculation or some imagination.
我们不想去聆听那一些所谓想象出来的啊，或是去臆测、凭空虚构的这种臆测的东西。
We want to hear what is actually the fact, factual.
我们想要聆听是什么？就说那些是事实、真理的。
So here's the quote, Srila Prabhupada would regularly, practically every morning, he would give lecture on Srimad Bhagavatam.
基本上呢 Srila Prabhupada 在世的时候每天早晨呢都会来讲述国家瓦坛这样的课程。
And so here, this is a lecture he gave in London in 1971.
啊，这里就是在1971年他在英国伦敦的时候所讲述的一个部分。
Alright, he said, unless you fully assimilate, meaning understand, you cannot describe it. So two things, simply reading will not help us. When we shall be able to preach the reading, doesn't matter whether in the same language or in my own language, that is wanting.
所以沙巴巴在这次的讲述就是说，除非你已经完全的所谓了解了，已经消化吸收了，否则你无法去描述它。所以有两件事，就是说你仅仅是去读它还不够啊，就不能帮助我们。我们必须能够去传扬这个教导啊，所以不论你用相同的语言或是我的这个语言，那都是要来做的。
So you can see Srimad Bhagavatam is presented today in Chinese. Here we have the Chinese edition. We have it translated into all the languages, many languages of the world.
所以我们可以看到呢，像佛教瓦坛啊这一些书呢，已经都有翻译成我们的中文，还有世界上很多的语言都已经翻译出来了。
So that doesn't matter what language it is. What's important is the subject matter.
所以，这个是哪一种语言不那么重要，最重要是说这个主题啊，这个内容的主旨。
We want to be able to.Share whatever we've understood from this Srimad Bhagavatam.
重点就是我们想要去分享，就是我们了解的佛教瓦坛啊，要去分享。
So we're going on now to the second part of this first chapter. We're going to hear about the qualities of people. After describing about the qualities of the speaker.We want to understand the qualification of the audience to hear Srimad Bhagavatam.
所以首先呢，我们来了解一个讲述者，一个老师的资格。现在接着我们来了解一下聆听者的资格。
So you can see the verse on the board here, one of the Sanskrit verses.
所以可以看一下这个是里面的诗节的一个部分。
You can all chant with me.
可以跟着念出这个范文这个部分吧。
Prayena upayusha shabhya Kalavasmin yuge jana Mandasu manda matayo Manda bhagya hiu padruta
Manda bhagya
hiu padruta This verse is describing about the nature of people in this age.
所以这节是描述的，就是说在这个卡密年代里面的人们。
First of all, Alpa Ayusha, meaning short life.
首先的一个字就是说短寿命，短命。Ayusha.
Ayusha, meaning the duration of life. So Alpa, very meager, very short.
Ayusha, 就是说就是 Alpa, 人类的寿命很短。
What is the problem? Is it because there's not enough food that we're living a short life?
怎么了吗？是因为缺乏食物，而且人民这样子人们短命吗
？Is anybody starving in Taiwan?
台湾有没有说闹饥荒
？Why are people getting sick?
那人们为什么生病呢
？Overeating.More people get sick from overeating than from undereating.
生病人大多是由于吃的过多，而不是说吃不够。
The people going to the doctors.
人们就要去看医生。
The people with the diabetes.
或者说有什么血糖问题。
The rich man's disease.
还有钱人的疾病。
They eat too much.
吃太多了。
So Prabhupada is describing the cause of the short life. Overeating, over sense gratification, over dependence on another's mercy, and artificial standards of living sap the very vitality of human energy. Therefore, the duration of life is short.
方法也说，就是过度的饮食，过度的感官享乐，过度的依赖其他人或其他生物的仁慈，或者说做作虚假的这种生活标准啊，这种呢把人们的生命活力抹杀了，所以人的寿命就变得短了。
It's so common, the artificial standards of living.
所以现在变得很普通、很普遍的，就是说很多生活上的生活水平是很表面或者是做作出来的。
You go to Hong Kong and you see people, they have from Hong Kong Central up to mid levels, they have an escalator, they have this moving platform, you know. People, they don't even have to walk anymore, they just stand on the escalator and they're carried up the hill to where their home, to their building, and there'll be a lift to take them up to their apartment. It's all so artificial.
我们如果去到香港，看到在香港的中环地区有一些地方是有一点坡度，那个建筑大楼有一些住家，有一些办公的大楼呢，就是在各个不同所以不同高度的坡度上。那如果从中环进，你到了中环呢，就是说你走路爬了一半，然后半路上就有那种自动的扶梯哈，就是把你带到山顶上去，你就说这是人们就可以去到山顶上的办公室或山顶上的住家，就连走路都不用了。所以就是说人都没有运动啊，这种生活的状态这是一种人为做出来的，也是一种表面上的所谓标准。
So we do have a short life compared to people in other yugas, other ages, Satya Yuga, Treta Yuga, Dwapara Yuga, Kali Yuga. If you live to be 100, oh, that's a really long life.
我们在这个年代人的寿命呢，跟其他的年代啦，Satya 年代啦，特塔年代啦，等等的其他年代的人的寿命比较，我们确实很短寿。如果我们说啊，100岁了已经是不得了了，哇，这么长寿。
In Satya Yuga, people were living 100,000, 1 lakh years.
在Satya年代，人们的寿命是100,000年的寿命。
And then in Treta Yuga, it was shortened to 10,000.
那再接着演进的特塔年代，人们呢变成10,000年的寿命。
And Dwapara Yuga became 1,000 years.
然后接着演进的 Dwapara 年代，人们只有1,000年的寿命。
And now Kali Yuga, not even 100.
那现在到了卡利年代，人们甚至不会到100岁的寿命。
And as Kali Yuga progresses, that will become less and less. The duration of life will be less and less.
那如果卡利年代的继续远近到卡利的末期的话，人的寿命已经减短了很多了。
The reason why the duration of life is reduced is because people are so irreligious.
为什么人们的寿命被减掉了这么多？是因为人们非常的不宗，非宗教性。
Right.Because of all the bad habits.
也是这个非宗教性，也是由于很多的恶习、坏习惯。
Then another quality of people described in Srimad Bhagavatam, we're described as being manda, that we're very slow and lazy and faulty.
那布达瓦坦说到卡利年代的人有一种品格叫 manda, 就是迟缓。 充满了错误、懒惰。
We use things like lives everywhere, and we have a toothbrush. We don't even use, you know, and we have an electric toothbrush to clean our teeth for us.
我们有一种手，本来我们用手刷牙啊，那个牙刷，现在都很多人用电动牙刷，你就只要压着手就可以，就让它自己去动。
Everywhere is washing machines. Nobody washes their clothes anymore. Everybody's got a washing machine.
大家大部分来说都有这个洗衣机啊，丢进去它就帮你洗了。人们基本上自己不洗衣的。
And people go for yoga to get exercise.
这些家务事都不用动了，可是就去这个瑜伽馆去做运动。
So we're very lazy in many ways.
所以我们在很多方面都是非常的懒。
And then another quality, Sumanda Matayo, that due to a bad system of education, men have no desire for self-realization.
再来是 Sumanda Matayo, 就是说，由于这个恶劣的教育系统，所以人们没有想要自我觉悟的愿望。
People's only desire is money, how to make money.
人们所想要就只是要钱啊，啊，做了什么各种文凭之后，就是想要去得到钱。
I was in Hong Kong and sometimes I would go to visit some of our donors there, and I remember I went to see a very wealthy Marwari gentleman who had a big company in Hong Kong. And he was sitting in his office and he picked up his phone and he was talking to the bank and said, he would say to the lady in the bank, just tell me, what do I have to do to make more money?
我自己亲眼见过，有一回我也是在香港，跟着去帮庙里募款，去一些印度人的办公室。那么其中有一个印度家族嘛，有管理这个办公室呢，这个老板正在讲电话，然后我听到这个电话里面这个人在吼着，这个老板就说，告诉我怎么样赚更多的钱，就前面说一大堆他都不管，他只要说你告诉我怎么赚更多的钱。
He was already very elderly.
这个年纪已经很老了。
And he'd gone through a heart attack, he'd had a bypass, and he'd done so much surgery.
这个年纪已经很大了，然后心脏也做了很多很重大的手术啦，心脏绕道啦，什么心血管怎么移植等等的手术。
The Vedas say, from the age of 50, pancha sorvam vanam brajet. Once you get over 50, you should go to forest. You should retire from material life.
那个人已经年纪那么老，身体都这个样子了，都还想要赚更多钱，是很可怜。但是经典告诉我们，人如果已经过了50岁的话，就要进行这个所谓灵修的活动了，去到森林修行啊等等。
The Vedic culture, life is divided into ashrams, right? After Grihastha ashram.You don't remain, you retire. And retirement means to take up spiritual activity.
所以韦达的这个系统呢，就是说把人类的生活分成四个阶段。你在前面遵守居士之后的阶段呢，就是一般说的退休阶段。但是你又物质的退休，可是实际上没有去退出来，你去进行灵修的这些活动。
But people have no proper education.
可是人们呢，没有恰当的教育。
They don't think about self-realization.
他们不会去想，就说觉悟自我这些。
Prabhuji, may I ask?
Yeah.
Can you explain a bit what you mean by self-realization?
By what?
Self-realization.
Self-realization? Self-realization means to understand our spiritual identity.
觉悟自我的意思就是说来了解我们有一个原来的灵性身份。
Generally, people are only thinking of the body. They think, I'm this body, I'm a material body. And we think my body's senses, and I have to satisfy my senses.
一般人都会认为，就我是这个身体，然后我这个身体有感官，我必须要满足这些感官。
So self-realization means to understand more than just simply the body, but to understand the self, the person, the spiritual person within the body, the soul, the atma.
所以，觉悟自我的意思就是说，来了解自己，不只是这个身体，而且是灵魂，是这个atma，是这个灵性的灵魂。
Without understanding our real self, we're just simply like the animals. Our only activities are eating and sleeping and mating and defending.
如果没有来了解自己真正的身份是灵魂的话呢，我们只是动物而已，就只是在进行这些吃啊、睡啊、交配啊、防卫这些活动。
But human life is meant for more than that. Human life has some intelligence. We're meant to inquire. We should be asking about who am I and what's going to happen to me when I have to give up this body. Where am I going to go?
具有人类身体要来自我觉悟的意思，就是要了解我是谁，然后我当我这一世这个身体要结束了之后，我将要去哪里，要做什么呢？
So this is self-realization. This is why you need to have a spiritual teacher to guide you in that realization.
所以像这样子的叫做自我觉悟，所以必须要有一个灵性的老师来引导你，来走向怎么样的自我觉悟。
But as we mentioned here, even somebody may be interested in self-realization, they may be victimized by unqualified, misguided teachers.
而在下面这个叙述说，即使说有些人他们想要来认识、知道、觉悟自我，可是有些人就是不幸的成为那没有资格的老师的误导，就是变成这样误导者的受害。
People don't know what is the actual qualification of a teacher.
因为人们不知道一个真正老师的资格是什么。
They think teacher somebody with a big beard and bright eyes.
他们有一些认为一个这个老师啊，大师就是说，他这个长发啦，长须啦，然后眼睛很大啦，或是身体怎么样的。
They don't know the importance of hearing. You have to hear from the teacher.
他们不知道聆听的重要，就是要从一个真正的老师那边去聆听。
Is that okay?
Yes.
Any other questions?
任何其他问题。
Yes. So you mentioned six philosophies.
Six systems.
Are they all different, or are they all these six philosophies want to give the same?
You mean separate or overlap?
Yeah,
so one come on one.
Are their goal is same, that self-realization or something, or they are very different?
Well, they're each giving different systems of philosophy, and their conclusions are also different.
刚刚说到的就是说，在知识有六种方式获得知识，那这六种类别知识呢，是有他们各自去获得知识的方式跟系统，但是在他们之间是个别分开的，而且每一种知识有它个别的结论。
But the very topmost system of philosophy is the one from Vyasadeva, which is teaching Vedanta.
然后呢，在这最这六种知识的系统里面呢，最高阶的就是Vyasadeva所教的这个Vedanta，或是说终极伟达经的这个伟达经结论的这个知识系统。
Veda means the knowledge, and Vedanta the end of knowledge. The end of knowledge is to understand the Supreme Absolute Truth, Lord Sri Krishna.
Veda 的意思是知识， Vedanta 就是说知识的终极，也就是知识的结论，所以 Vedanta 就是所有知识的最终极，它的结论。
So self-realization also comes in stages. There's realization first of our own self as an Atma, as a soul, but then you want to go on and understand the Supreme Soul.
所以这个自我觉悟也是有它的阶段，首先先领悟到就是说啊，我们个体是一个个体灵魂，然后接着呢就是也想去了解还有自尊灵魂。
If we only understand ourselves as a soul, then our realization is not really complete.
如果说我们只是领悟到我们是灵魂的话呢，我们的领悟还不完整。
You want to understand what is your function, what is your duty as a soul.
我们而且要了解灵魂的身份，也要了解灵魂的活动，它的功能。
So that is yoga. Yoga is to connect to the Supreme.
所以去了解灵魂的这个活动跟功能呢，就由瑜伽这个联系来进行。
So you can see how difficult it is for us in the age of Kali that we're so unqualified.
所以我们可以看到，我们在卡利年代，这些人类说起来是非常没有资格的。
Yeah, there's a few more qualities. These are not mine. This is Srila Vyasadeva himself. He was predicting what are the qualities of people in the Kali Yuga.
这一些描述呢，不是我个人自己说出来，这是 Vyasadeva 他已经说到了在卡利年代的人的品质。
So another quality, Manda Bhagya. Bhagya meaning good luck, so Manda Bhagya, bad luck.
Manda Bhagya 就是厄运，坏运啊。Bhagya 是运气啊，这个坏厄运。
So Prabhupada is describing how we get caught in many different things like cinemas and, you know, today it's the hand phone, everybody's playing with their hand phone. There's some young children, all they do the whole day is with their hand phone and play the games, and we get caught in all of these bad things, you see.
所以这个年代人们就是被这个所以各种物质状态的受害者或者我们现在看到社会上的年轻人呢，几乎人手一机啊，整天呢不是在看什么，就是在玩电动游戏或追剧。
Sports, you know, go to in the UK football, you know, everyone goes to the football match. In America, it's baseball and different sports. People.
各种运动啊，在英国人们去看足球啦，去这个体育馆看足球。在美国，他们去看棒球啊，人们被很多各种运动活动啊。
Or gambling, everyone likes to go to Macau. You say go to Macau, and, and they'll go and gamble, and people just love to go and gamble.
或者说赌博啊，人们说我们去澳门去那边享受啊，去赌一赌啊。
And nobody goes gambling ever wins, you know, everybody loses, but still so many people go.
去赌的人呢，基本上都输了，没有人赢，可是人们还是这样的涌去这个赌场。
And then you've got things like smoking and drinking.
还有人们去抽烟啊，喝酒啦，这一些。
All of this, so these are all symptoms of this Kali Yuga. People get so victims of all of these things. And once you start doing these things, it's so difficult to stop.
而且如果人们去开始去进行这类的活动，就好像脱不了了，就没办法放弃。
Trying to give up drinking tea is very difficult.
甚至要放弃喝茶也很难。
Smoking, people get very attached. Although everybody knows very bad.
或者说抽烟啊，人们也是很难放弃，很难戒烟。
And finally here, upadruta, always disturbed, full of anxiety.
再来还有一项就是 ，he who perturbs， 就是说啊，人的心一直充满着焦虑啊，一直被干扰着。
One of the biggest industries in the world today, pharmacy. The drug stores do a great business. People count you.
啊，现在世界有一个很大的生意，就是药哈、啊、药药类药啊药物方面的生意。
So many pills.
人们必须吃很多种药物。
Pill to stop the hair going gray.
有没有说让你头发不要变白的药物啊？
So many pills they have for everything.
现在很多很多种的药了。
So this is the affairs in the Kali Yuga.
那这是在卡利年代里面的这些世界。
So many problems.
卡利年代有很多的问题。
But there's one good thing about Kali Yuga.
卡利年代有一件好事。
Simply by chanting Hare Krishna.
就仅仅是单单就是念诵 Hare Krishna 已经是很大的那个帮助。
So we encourage you all to chant Hare Krishna, make your life successful.
I encourage all of you to chant Hare Krishna, then make your life successful.
Any questions?
Any questions?
Anyone? So we spoke about the qualifications of the speaker.Just as the speaker is qualified, audience also qualified.
所以我们提到就是说讲的人必须要有资格，那聆听者也必须要有资格。
No? What's the qualification for the audience, do you think?
你们认为聆听者必须要什么样的资格？
The speaker should be qualified, the audience have to be also. You may have a very good speaker, the audience may not be qualified.
这个讲述者必须要有资格啊，那就是说你有一个很有资格的人的讲述者，可是呢，有时候听众并没有资格。
So what's the qualification for the good audience?
哎，好的。
Listening.
好的聆听者，但是怎么定义呢？ How to define the good listener?
Good listener.
Humble.
Yeah. No, purpose, right? Yeah, you should be eager to hear.
必须要有这个急切想要聆听。
Wants to hear. He hears with rapt attention.
非常专注的聆听哈。
Yeah, you really want to hear.
你真的想要聆听了。
That eagerness to hear.
急切的要聆听。
That's the most important quality.
是最重要的品质。
All right, so thank you all very much.
谢谢大家。